Morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship, this day in which we remember the baptism of our Lord. We're done with the Christmas season now. We've passed Epiphany, and we're into this season of Epiphany. But today's the special day when we focus on the baptism of Jesus. My name is Jean Larson. I'm a retired ELCA pastor, and I'm happy to be with you all today, seeing some old friends and some new faces. Please note the announcements in your bulletin. There are a bunch of them. I'll highlight only a few. The annual meeting will be February 5th, and annual reports for that meeting are due in the office by January 16th. Women in Mission meet in room 208 next Sunday after the first service, and you'll have a Red Cross blood drive on Tuesday the 17th. There's information on how to register for that drive in the bulletin. Flowers today have been given by Gail and Gerhard Knudsen in memory of Paul Crowley, of blessed memory. We will need two helpers to distribute the wine in communion. We'll have one communion station today. Do I have volunteers to cover the wine and grape juice? Two people. Great. One more. Okay, we're good. Thank you. Are there any other announcements that you would like to highlight or make? Then I invite you to please stand as you are able as we begin our worship today. We are privileged to gather together in the presence of our God and in the presence of one another. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
You better.
Holy One, source of our renewal, we confess that we are wrapped up in sin and cannot free ourselves. We have not practiced your righteousness. Our hearts have turned away from you. For the sake of the world you so love, forgive us that we may be reconciled to one another for the glory of your holy name. Amen. Thus says our God, the former things have come to pass, and new things I now declare. God's mercy makes us new. We are forgiven in the name of Christ our Savior. Amen. You may be seated. Come on up for the children's sermon. We're going to gather around the font today. I know Coulter's not here. He's at another congregation. But if you could come up here, I'll do my best. Hi. I'm Pastor Jean. It's good to be with you today. You know, today we celebrate the baptism of Jesus. Now, you girls might have been baptized. Do you know? Have you been baptized? Yeah. Well, not everybody is, and that's okay, but it's cool that you're baptized because Jesus got baptized too, and he said, this is what I want you to do. So, you might remember when you were, well, maybe you were babies when you were baptized. Do you remember? Yeah, no. Whoops, be careful. Yeah, be careful with the step there. I was a baby too, so I don't remember, but here's the thing. That when Jesus was baptized, he was baptized in a river, which we usually aren't. I think that would be hard to be baptized like in the Clark Fork River right now. It'd be cold. But Jesus was baptized in the river, and when he came up out of the river, he heard a voice came down from heaven, and everybody heard this voice and said, "You are my son, the beloved one. With you I am well pleased." And that's really special. God said, Jesus, I'm so happy with you. So go ahead and put your hands in the water, play with the water. So when you were baptized, the pastor put some water on your forehead. And what I want you to understand is that God says the same words to you as he did to Jesus. Right? When you're baptized, and every day God says to you, you are my beloved child. I'm delighted with you. You are my beloved child. I am delighted with you. So that's really neat. Whenever you might feel a little down, just remember that, hey, I'm baptized and God's delighted in me. So here's another thing you can do. Get your hand wet. And then this is what the pastor did when you were baptized, and you can remember this. And make the sign of the cross on your forehead with the water. And then you say, I'm baptized and God delights in me. Yeah, that's right. Very good. Yes, and that's the truth for all of us. Thanks, girls. You can go sit down.
The first reading is from Isaiah chapter 42, verses 1 through 9. Here is my servant, whom I uphold, my chosen, in whom my soul delights. I have put my spirit upon him. He will bring forth justice to the nations. He will not cry or lift up his voice or make it heard in the street. A bruised reed he will not break, and a dimly burning wick he will not quench. He will faithfully bring forth justice. He will not grow faint or be crushed until he has established justice in the earth, and the coastlands wait for his teaching. Thus says God the Lord, who created the heavens and stretched them out, who spread out the earth and what comes from it, who gives breath to the people upon it and spirit to those who walk in it. I am the Lord. I have called you in righteousness. I have taken you by the hand and kept you. I have given you as a covenant to the people, a light to the nations, to open the eyes that are blind, to bring out the prisoners from the dungeon, from the prisons, those who sit in darkness. I am the Lord, that is my name. My glory I give to no other, nor my praise to idols. See, the former things have come to pass, and new things I now declare. Before they spring forth, I tell you of them. The psalm for today is Psalm 29, and we'll read it responsively. Ascribe to the Lord, you gods, ascribe to the Lord glory and strength.
Ascribe to the Lord glory to God's name. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness.
The voice of the Lord is upon the waters. The God of glory thunders. The Lord is upon the mighty waters.
The voice of the Lord is a powerful voice.
The voice of the Lord breaks the cedar trees. The Lord breaks the cedars of Lebanon.
The Lord makes Lebanon stick like a calf and Mount Hermon like a young wild ox.
The voice of the Lord bursts forth in lightning flashes.
The voice of the Lord shakes the wilderness. The Lord shakes the wilderness of Kadesh.
The voice of the Lord makes the oak trees writhe and strips the forests bare. And in the temple of the Lord, all are crying, glory.
The Lord sits enthroned above the flood. The Lord sits enthroned as king forevermore.
O Lord, give strength to your people. Give them, O Lord, the blessings of peace. The second reading is from Acts chapter 10, verses 34 to 43. Peter began to speak to Cornelius and his household. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. How he went about doing good and healing all those who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. Here ends the word.
The Holy Gospel according to Matthew chapter 3.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Then Jesus came from Galilee to John at the Jordan to be baptized by John. John would have prevented him, saying, "I need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me?" But Jesus answered him, "Let it be so now, for it is proper for us in this way to fulfill all righteousness." Then he consented. And when Jesus had been baptized, just as he came up from the water, suddenly the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, "This is my Son, the Beloved, with whom I am well pleased." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Last week, my three-year-old granddaughter, June, and I were playing with one of our nativity sets. We were bringing the kings in from the east in the basement to do the Epiphany up properly, and she was happily arranging the baby Jesus, Mary, and Joseph in the little stable thing. Then she held up Joseph and said, "Grandma Jean, is this God?" And I said, "No, Junie, this is Joseph. He's Mary's husband." And then she said, "But isn't God Jesus' daddy?" And I thought, oh, I didn't expect to be working with Christology with her so soon. And I said, "Yes, God is Jesus' daddy, but we can't see him or touch him. God lives in heaven and in our hearts." And then she says, "But I want to see God and I want to touch him." Oh, Junie, don't we all? I told her, that's why Jesus came. He was a person like us, so that we can see God in Jesus. But I don't think that completely satisfied her, because we can't exactly see Jesus now either. But it's the best we've got, and really, it's very, very good. Still, when I told her we'd be putting away the nativity set until next Christmas, she said, "No, Grandma Jean, I would be very sad if you did that. I want to come back next week and play with Jesus again." And since I am the softest touch where June is concerned, the nativity set will stay put, and June will have more opportunities to delve into the mysteries of God's presence among us. And we have more such opportunities today, because with the baptism of Jesus, we are confronted with some great Christological questions of our own. Like, why did Jesus need to be baptized anyway? John was baptizing for the forgiveness of sins, and a classic doctrine of the church says that Jesus did not sin, even though he was fully human, and divine. So what is his baptism all about? We have good questions of our own, indeed. But first, let's back up a little bit and get clear about what John was up to at the Jordan. In order to do this, we have to go back to the Old Testament, to that first crossing of the Jordan. Remember? Joshua led the Israelites into the promised land after Moses had died, and they had to cross the Jordan to get there. It was a crossing into not just a land, but into freedom and fullness of life with the promise of God. This historical memory was very much part of John's baptizing in the Jordan. The site was no accident. So baptism took on that same sense of crossing into freedom and fullness of life in the promise of God. John's message was unequivocal. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. Change your ways, confess your sins, make yourselves ready for God. Now, although I tend to see John as a fearsome figure, and maybe you do too, his message really was one of hope and balm for the people who came out to him. I mean, they came out from all over. It says earlier in Matthew's gospel that they came from Jerusalem and all over Judea, because their lives were totally defined by Roman occupation, brutal taxation, compromised religious leadership, poverty, indebtedness. Rebellion was violently suppressed. John's way offered a new path, a new righteousness, and what's more, a new community that they could live a new life in. Not only as individuals, which was important, they needed to purify themselves, but also as God's people together. They needed to live together in a faithful and hopeful community. I bet some of you know what this is like. When life has you down and there seems to be no way out, the Spirit of God comes through a pastor or a friend or a reading or whatever. The Holy One gets very creative here. She spoke to me on the radio back in the day. So you hear the Spirit of God saying, change your life, come this way, follow me. Yes? The change here is certainly individual, but it is not only individual. For Christians are baptized into the community of faith, and it is as the community that we have the support we need to be faithful. We'll get back to this later. But first, let's return to John the Baptist. I don't think it's hard at all to understand why all those people came out to him at the Jordan to be baptized. But what about Jesus? Why did he come? What was he seeking? Here we meet Jesus for the first time as an adult. The Gospels are notoriously silent about how Jesus grew up. Only Luke's gospel gives us that little glimpse of Jesus at age 12 in the temple with the rabbis. But then he too falls silent. So for the most part, we go from the baby Jesus in the manger to Jesus at about age 28, having walked 80 miles south from his home in Nazareth to meet up with John at the Jordan. Why? Now we can ponder the doctrine. Did Jesus need to repent or not? But I don't think that's very helpful. Instead, let's look at the result of his baptism. What do you notice when you look at the outcome? I mean, after his baptism, Jesus' life took a U-turn. He did not go back to live with his family. If he had been a carpenter like Joseph, which is likely, he put away his tools forever. After his time in the wilderness, he started proclaiming the same message as John. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near. But he didn't just proclaim it, he made it real. Healing the sick, forgiving the sinner, gathering a community, bringing God's kingdom near to his people who were in a world of hurt. So the outcome of Jesus' baptism was that his life was changed. And that's what repentance means, after all. Change your life. Turn around. Live for God. And Jesus certainly did. Matthew tells us simply that Jesus was baptized to fulfill all righteousness. Fulfill all justice. It's the same word. Maybe that's all we need to know. If Jesus was seeking anything, he was seeking to do God's will. And And we know that he did, because when he comes up out of the water, that voice from heaven announces to everyone, "This is my son, the beloved, with whom I am well pleased." And then Jesus got to work, but not on his own. His first act as a public ministry guy was gathering his disciples, gathering his friends, and together they set out to live the kingdom. So does Jesus' baptism have anything to say about ours? I grew up thinking that baptism was my ticket to heaven. I'm not sure that the church taught it exactly that way, but that was my takeaway. Baptism was an individual matter between me and God. My sins were forgiven, and I was called to fulfill all righteousness the best I could. Now, that became a problem because I couldn't. I was a very pious little girl, and I tried my best, but I just couldn't. I had very annoying older brothers, and they got in the way of my righteousness. And then I grew a little and became a young woman dealing with the world, and here I am getting to be an old lady, and I am still so far from righteousness that it's laughable. It's funny how grace and daily forgiveness, which are the gifts of baptism, right? Funny how those things worked with all of my striving, all of my trying so hard. God's grace was very real to me, and always has been, and made it possible for me to breathe. But years ago, I came to see that something was missing in my conception of the faithful life, something essential. And that was community and the role that the church plays in helping me or any of us to be faithful. That's not quite the right way to put it. The role it plays in helping us be collectively faithful. Now, the church's teaching on baptism has changed, thank God. It's not an individual's ticket to heaven. It is God's indelible welcome of each of the baptized into the community of the faithful. To each of us, God says, "You are my child. My beloved, I am delighted in you. Let that soak in. You are my beloved. I am delighted." And as the beloved, we are called to bring God's justice to the world, but not on our own. Our call is communal. With the church, the communion of saints, we are called to work for Jesus' justice. After all, we say that the church collectively is the body of Christ, not any single one of us. The horrible burden of individual righteousness is a real problem. At least it has been to me. It blinded me to God's delight. I mean, how could God be delighted in me when I was such a slacker? Or when I was exhausted or depressed and unable to help anybody else? But as part of the beloved community, I can rest when I need to, and others take up the work. It's okay not to have all the answers, because I finally learned to trust the community to come up with them. What a relief. What grace and blessing. This is my hope for Junie, my beautiful granddaughter. You ought to meet her. You'd agree. At 3, she knows that Jesus loves her, and she loves him back fiercely. May she always know God's holy delight in her. And may we, all of us, know God's holy delight in us. Even as we deal with the challenges of life, we are surrounded by faithful friends to remind us of God's delight and to take up the work of following Jesus together. That's the pattern he set, after all. The beloved son does God's work with his friends for his people. and for us. Thanks be to God.
Called together to follow Jesus, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. Calling God, you speak with power to your church. Open our hearts and minds to the new things you are declaring. Strengthen bishops, pastors, lay leaders, and teachers of the faith. Equip the baptized for your reconciling and redeeming work. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Renewing God, you provide the waters of the earth, and in Jesus' baptism, you reveal the waters of life. Cleanse and protect oceans, rivers, and watersheds. Bring relief to parched lands and to communities without access to safe water. Lord, in your mercy, righteous God, you never weary of establishing justice. Increase cooperation and constructive dialogue between nations. Guide local, national, and international authorities to govern with equity, vision, and integrity, and grant thoughtful, peaceful, and healthy transitions in our state and federal houses of government. We pray for those in the military and for peacemakers, especially those who would work to achieve peace in Ukraine, and for our enemies. Lord, in your mercy. Abiding God, your mercy is steadfast. Give sanctuary to people who flee from oppression, war, poverty, and famine. Sustain healthcare workers, caregivers, first responders, counselors, and all who help and heal. Comfort those who are grieving, experiencing crisis, or in need of healing, especially Peggy, Richard's brother, Gloria, and Phyllis. and Pastor Mike Harmon and the congregation of St. Joseph Lutheran Church in Alberta, which was destroyed by fire on December 31st. Lord, in your mercy. Blessing God, in Christ you gathered the beloved community. Kindle the gifts of your Spirit in your people. Accompany the newly baptized, those recently ordained, and all beginning a new ministry. Inspire synodical leaders and congregational councils to serve with imagination and wisdom. Hear now are the concerns which we silently lift before you. Lord, in your mercy, promising God, your faithfulness endures throughout all generations. We give thanks for those who have died in Christ, trusting that we will be united with them and all the saints in Christ's resurrection. Lord, in your mercy, we bring to you all our needs and hopes, O God, trusting your wisdom and power revealed in Christ. Amen.
Please stand as you are able. And please pray with me. Liberating God, you break the bonds of injustice and let the oppressed go free. Receive these offerings in thanksgiving for all your works of merciful power and shape us as people of your justice and freedom. You we magnify and adore through Jesus our Savior. Amen. We remember that in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." We are bold to pray as our Lord taught us, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, this is the feast of Christ our Lord. We are his guests. All are welcome at the table. Please come, for all is ready. You may be seated.
Thank you.
Please stand as you are able. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. Holy One, we thank you for the healing that springs forth abundantly from this table. Renew our strength to do justice, love kindness, and journey humbly with you. Amen. May the God who faithfully brings forth justice and breaks the oppressor's rod bless, strengthen, and uphold you now and always. Amen. Go in peace. Follow the way of Jesus.